A very good morning and welcome members and staff back from summer recess and to the 23rd meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. We have apologies this morning from Pauline McNeill, and our first item of business today is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Our next item of business is consideration of a negative statutory instrument, that's namely the Offensive Weapons Act of 2019, Prescribed Documents, Scotland Order of 2022, that's SSI number 210 of 2022, and I refer members to paper number 1. So this SSI adds a United Kingdom photo card driving licence as a valid form of ID for the purposes of a defence to two new criminal offences under the Offensive Weapons Act of 2019 operating in Scotland. So that is a Section 39 offence relating to a delivery company delivering bladed products sold by UK-based sellers to a person aged under 18 at residential premises, and a Section 42 offence relating to a delivery company who has entered into an arrangement with a seller based outside the UK to deliver a bladed article to a person under 18 years of age. So can I just ask members if you have any questions on the instrument at all?
No.
No? No. Okay. In that case, are members content not to make any recommendations to the Parliament on the instrument? Okay. Thank you very much. So our next agenda item is consideration of a number of items of correspondence that the committee received over the summer recess, and I refer members to paper number 2. So you will see that the clerks have made some suggestions for follow-up in the table at paragraph 3 in the paper. So I'd like to propose that we take each letter in turn and ask the committee for any views and for agreement on how we wish to proceed with each of them. So just looking at the table at paragraph 3, if we start off with the letter received from the Minister for Community Safety in relation to legal aid. So I'll just open it up to members who wish to make any comments on the correspondence. Russell?
Just subsequent to the correspondence from the Minister, we've had something from the Edinburgh Bar Association, so it might be worth just incorporating some of their points that they've made in response to her, if we're writing to her.
Okay.
That's about that.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, thank you. Anyone else?
Jamie,
and then Katie, I'll bring Jamie in first.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. I echo that comment. The letter was quite late received, so may not necessarily be widely in the public domain, but nonetheless, it's of relevance. I think what it does suggest, though, that there clearly is still some ongoing dispute. A number of members have asked, both in the committee but also in the wider chamber, questions of the Community Safety Minister responsible for that portfolio about this dispute around legal aid. And I think the letter yesterday quite clearly showed that the matter is far from resolved. Indeed, quite the opposite. And it's not necessarily just this agreement around the numbers or the quantity of money that's been offered by the government, but it's clearly a disagreement around the facts and the historic journey that they've both been on to get to the point they're at. And I think what I'm struggling with, perhaps from a neutral standpoint, is what are the facts? Who's right in this instance? They can't both be right if there's such a vocal and vehement disagreement between the two parties. So I'd quite like to perhaps ask perhaps maybe Spice or other colleagues could provide a timeline for us that would outline exactly what journey they've gone through with the assignment of budget to legal aid, any changes that were made, any additional funds that were made available by the government, how that was received and so on, just so we get to the point of today, because I think there's two parallel conversations happening between those in the sector at the front line who are clearly in huge disagreement with the government, almost to the point of stating yesterday in the letter that the minister was being less than forthcoming with the facts. But the minister clearly has quite a robust point of view, which I also hear that she feels that that's an appropriate response. So before we go to the, before we hear any further, because we're just getting into a tit for tat, I think, if we just keep writing back and forward between them, we're not the mediator in this, it's not our job to solve the problem. But I'm just getting to that point now where I feel like the criminal lawyers are at their wits' end at the matter and warning all sorts of things down the line, which I think should be of concern to the committee. But equally, the government seems quite robust in its defence. And I'm just struggling to get to the nub of the problem here. What are the numbers? What was promised and not delivered, or what was over-delivered but not promised, and so on and so forth. So that's the only comment I make, and it's not taking either side in the dispute.
Thanks very much, Jamie. Katie?
I mean, I would echo everything that's been said. I mean, it seems to me that the government keeps saying that the rates have been agreed, and that's something that we've heard evidence on before. And I mean, I don't think that's particularly fair. I think what the profession says, well, they had no choice. That was what was on the table. And if they didn't take that, there wouldn't be any increase. I think we do have some information in the papers, particularly about early rates. And I don't think, we need to have a huge amount of kind of financial knowledge to understand what they mean at page 10. I mean, obviously, there's been an increase in the use of, fixed fee arrangements, but the hourly rates haven't kept up with the rate of inflation or any other indicator of what you would expect. So, I mean, I think it's quite apparent there's been massive cuts in legal aid and that solicitors in particular get paid a lot less in real terms than they would 25 years ago. Now, it may be that the Scottish Government can provide some justification for that, but I actually don't think we need a huge amount more evidence to know that's clearly the case. And it's clear that there's a huge amount of anger in England also, there's similar problems, and barristers are now in strike. And, we've already had some strikes in Scotland from the legal profession in terms of, decisions not to carry out certain types of work. So it's clearly a very heated situation. I don't think we are mediators. I don't think we can, perform that function. We're also going into a period of austerity. We were told that the cuts to the budgets in the justice sector were going to be approximately 20%, and that was when inflation was lower. So I think the backdrop is one where this problem is probably going to get a great deal more serious, because presumably the Cabinet Secretary and relevant ministers will have very little at their disposal in terms of flexibility financially. So I think the situation is highly concerning. It's clear there's been massive cuts. I'm not exactly sure what role we can play. We're not mediators, but I think we have to accept that there have been massive cuts in the legal aid budgets, and the consequences of that are that some of the most vulnerable will not be getting the support that really we would like them to have. And I think that's the message that this committee should be giving, that we recognise that there has been significant cuts and that has an impact.
Thanks very much. Rona.
Thank you, Convener. I really just want to agree with Jamie Green's comments. I don't think we do have all. I think there's an impasse, clearly. I don't think we do have all the facts set out clearly to us. That said, we clearly aren't mediators, but it would be good to know more about the background to it. So I agree with, I think that's a sensible proposition to just ask for a fairly, easy to understand timeline for us to know what's been going on. And I think, after we get that, we can consider if there's any role for this committee in this or not. Not to say that it's not concerning, but it's clearly work ongoing. So, okay.
Thanks, Rona. Fulton?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just wanted to briefly comment and take the opportunity to say that I've had some contact from some lawyers on this, including constituents who have obviously raised concern. And I think just saying what Katie Clark has just said there, there is concerns about, from their point of view, the funding of legal aid and the ability, therefore, for defence lawyers to operate. And clearly, when we're dealing with a backlog, that wouldn't be a situation which would be good. But similarly to Rona Mackay and Jamie Green, you know, it also feels as if the government have got quite a robust response to that as well. So we're not mediators, as others have said, but I do think it is worth... I think that the suggestion from the clerks is the right one, that we take it into the budget scrutiny period that we're going into and have a look at it then and can perhaps ask stakeholders and the government more about this to see if this impasse, which is... Which does seem to be there, can be navigated around, because I don't think it will be anybody's interest. And we know that the government won't want a situation where the backlog can't be cleared because defence lawyers can't do their work either. So I think the suggestion is right. But I did want to just take the opportunity to say, because I have had several correspondences. I'm imagining that some have went to all committee members, but I've also had about two or three constituents contact me as well. So I wanted to take the opportunity to put that on the record today.
Yeah. Okay, thanks very much. Jamie, yep.
Apologies, don't want to prolong the debate too much, but I think aside from the budget scrutiny aspect, which is a valid one, although there's limitations as to our involvement in that, we can only identify what the government has to offer and whether that's received well or not is out of our control. But I think the other issue more is about headcount and resource in the sector, because clearly... The paragraph, I think, that's of more importance to us, given the other work that the committee is doing from the Edinburgh Bar Association yesterday, is that when they state that the government is presently consulting on proposals to give complainers in sexual offence cases the right to legally aided independent legal advice. And the question is, who does the government propose to represent them? So they're obviously warning of clear a delta between... the number of people coming forward with cases and the amount of people available to represent them or indeed offer them independent advice. We already know that there are, throughout the country and have been for a while, not just because of the backlog, but clearly resource or lack of representation is already an issue across the country. So what we don't want, I guess, is a situation where people going through the justice system are facing unnecessary delays to cases or trials, or simply not having access to representation on either side, both the accused and the complainers. And that is a different issue, which I think we need to keep a watchful eye on, because if the warnings do come to fruition, then, you know, a year during the lifetime of this Parliament, we could be looking at quite a substantial crisis in that sector. And I think that only has a knock-on effect on clearing the backlog and people held on remand and waiting for their day in court and so on, and we know all the consequences that has on folks. So I just wonder how we work that into our workload as well to ensure that that's not something that just creeps up on us in a year or two.
Okay, thanks very much, Jamie. Colette, did you want to come in?
Yeah, just echoing really what everyone else has commented on and the fact that we shouldn't be the mediators, but arguably our... You know, more importantly is the impact it has on the victims. You know, I think that's at the heart of this as well, if this is going to go on and, you know, there's an impasse in some way. And one of the things I just wanted to get clarification on is they're looking for a 50% uplift, is that correct? Whereas I'm sure in England and Wales it's 25%, but there was a paragraph as well talking about that somebody's been commissioned as well to look at it. I'm just wondering if we could draw some comparisons as well from I think it was a Sir Christopher Bellamy QC that was actually looking at, to draw some comparisons to see before we get anywhere near going into a strike action. That's the last thing we want.
OK, thank you very much for that. Some very valid points made. I think not least of all, just a recognition of our role within the committee or what our role is not within the committee at this point in time. I found both sets of correspondence actually to be quite comprehensive and very helpful in a way, and they've certainly set out the sort of historical context of where we are today with legal aid provision. It's clearly not a straightforward situation, and there are clearly challenges remaining in terms of everybody getting to the point that they would like to be at. And I entirely agree with you, Colette, around the need for us to ideally reach a system where those working within it, but those who are in receipt of the services provided within legal aid, their needs are met. So can I propose, given I don't want to repeat what members have already covered, I'm more than happy for us to pick up the points that members have made and link with SPICE to get some further information on the context, the timeline that Jamie mentioned. More than happy for that. I think that would be very helpful for us. I do note that the Minister had, or the Minister is currently in negotiations with the Scottish Government's in negotiations at the moment, and has undertaken to update us on progress of the negotiations, as well as the review of the Public Defender Solicitor's Office. But I'm happy if members are in agreement that we write to the Minister for an update on progress of the negotiations and refer, obviously, to the Edinburgh Bar Association letter that we received yesterday. We also will cover off this issue in terms of our budget scrutiny. That will be an important part of that forthcoming process. So if members are in agreement, I would propose that we link with SPICE and write to the Minister on the points that we've raised. Members happy with that?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, thanks very much. So moving on to our second letter, which was from the Scottish Government outlining its plans following the consultation of the not proven verdict and other matters. And obviously we heard the update in Chamber yesterday in relation to the programme for government around the proposals to abolish the not proven verdict. Do members wish to make any comment on that correspondence, Rona?
Really just to put on record my delight that the not proven verdict is going to be abolished, and as we heard yesterday, I think this is good news for victims, particularly victims of sexual crimes. And yes, I mean it's quite a historic, quite a radical change, but it's one I think is long overdue. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay. Russell, Russell then, Jamie.
Just to also echo the fact that this is a good development. It was something that was in our party's manifesto during the last election, and indeed was in my colleague's private member's bill, and this will push it forward. And I think also we should be grateful to those who responded to the consultation. Now, of course, there was the those who you'd expect to respond, but quite a lot of members of the public who have suffered from the verdict, including Miss M, and indeed families who've lost members to murder and not had justice as they see it. So some really compelling responses in there that are worth taking time to look at. So,
Jamie.
Yes, thank you. Naturally, this is of interest to me because it may have a knock-on effect on my own members' bill, as the abolition of not proven was one of the key pillars of it. And I'll liaise with the authorities on what happens next in that respect and try and work constructively with the Cabinet Secretary on that. I did, however, note, and I'll say this for both my own bill and the responses to this one, is that there weren't a huge amount of responses, but I think the responses that were received were of quality and substance. And again, I can't say too much about the statistics in response to my own question and my own consultation on the issue of not proven. because we haven't published them yet, but they will be soon, but they're not far away from the statistical responses that the government got, and they weren't necessarily overwhelmingly in favour of the abolition. 62% is a high bar, but it's not the highest in terms of other responses to other questions that were asked. So I think it is fair to say that it's not quite, and we all know this, but it's not quite as simple as just abolishing a verdict. It will require, as part of the whichever bill it forms part of, a whole raft of other changes. And it's very clear, I mean, you know, the immediate response to yesterday's news from a number of folk within the justice sector and a number of justice partners who we rely on as key cogs in the wheel, you know, have reservations about it. They expressed that to me when I announced my plans as well, and I hear them. And therefore, I think it's really important whatever happens next. I know the bill will go through robust scrutiny and consultation, as all bills do, especially if it comes through this committee. However, what will need to be clear as the government moves forward with the not proven issue is the what next. What other changes may have to be made? How will this have wider implications? And it's really unclear at the moment. It's you know, it's an easy question to ask and a very difficult question to answer as to what effect that will have on trials, on outcomes within our courts. And I think it's that which we will need to pay a huge amount of careful and considerate cognizance to the voices who work in that sector, whether we agree with them or not, whether they agree with us or not, whether they agree with the government or not. That's by the by. They clearly have a lot of experience, and I think we've all experienced that over the last few weeks of talking to judges, talking to solicitors and barristers and advocates, what effect these things will have on trials. But I think overall, yes, it seems to be a step forward if it's finally delivered after hundreds of years of discussion. But time will tell.
OK, thanks very much. Anybody else want to come in on that? Okay, thanks. I, like everybody else, I very much welcome the this announcement. I think it's moving Scotland in terms of our judicial system in the right direction, which is a very good thing. Obviously, next steps will be around the bill, and I think you're right. The issue of removing not proven will be a lot of work, for sure. Will require a review of sort of jury majorities and this possibly corroboration too, but we'll just wait and see what comes forward in the bill and monitor that, obviously, in terms of content. So thanks very much for that. So a third letter is the letter from the Minister for Drugs Policy on the new National Drugs Mission Oversight Group. Any comments on that correspondence? Russell?
Just to say that the letter we received happened to be dated the same day as the first meeting of this new group, and it does say that details will be made available on the government website. I don't know if indeed that is the case, but I certainly would like to know when they're next planning to meet, and just rough idea of schedules. And given there's international members in the list of 20 that we have in front of us, just what the format would be. Presumably they wouldn't be travelling to Scotland every time the group meets, but just curious about that.
Yeah. Okay. Any other comments? Nope. Okay. Happy to write and ask for that information, Russell. Okay. Thanks very much. Next letter was from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans on the funding for recovery cafes in Scottish prisons. Comments on that correspondence? I think obviously we're aware of the statement on the national mission coming forward, I think tomorrow in the chamber, which I think will also possibly incorporate an update on work to progress provisions such as recovery cafes. So if members are happy, we'll just agree to the recommendations in the table. Yep. Okay, thank you. Okay, moving on. Our next letter was from the Scottish Prison Service on access to fresh air. So I think we had some confirmation of the provision in place at the moment around fresh air. Any comments on that? Okay. Jamie?
I know it's perhaps a slightly wider issue, but the issue around purposeful activity amongst the Roman population, I think, is still an unaddressed issue. And I appreciate that's not the question that we asked, therefore it's not in this answer. But I'm not 100% convinced that there's enough being done in that respect, and I appreciate there are legal ramifications to that, perhaps statutory duties that do or do not take place. But nonetheless, I would like to think that the SPS are actively looking at, even within the confines of what the law states people's rights are or not, or what they can and cannot force people to do, that they would go above and beyond in that respect, because, you know, we all know the statistics out yesterday pointed towards quite a dire situation in terms of people being held on remand for lengthy periods due to the court delays. So I'd like to think that there's more than just the bare minimum being done, and I wonder if we could maybe ask more information about that.
Thanks very much. Anybody else want to come in, Colette?
Yeah, thanks, convener. I would just agree with Jamie. I mean, it's saying open air and also purposeful activity, which are two completely different things. My understanding of, well, I'd like to seek further clarification on what they're saying is purposeful activity, because my understanding of it is it's PT time, it's downtime, not you know, it's different from open air. There's also the work element when they go, you know, to the work sheds and things like that as well. So they're not out in the fresh air. So there's two different elements to that altogether. So just to seek clarification on that.
Okay. Anybody else got any comments? No. Okay. I think the only thing I would raise is or mention is obviously we're reviewing this and other issues around prison in our action plan. But I think we can expect access to activities for remand prisoners possibly to be covered in the bail and release bill coming forward. So, but certainly we can monitor the issues around fresh air and purposeful activity as part of our wider work. And I think it's appropriate that we do that. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, the next correspondence was from the prison service again on the issue of medical slips to prisoners on release. Any comments on that? Rona, sorry.
Yeah, I mean, the response tells us what we knew, basically. I'm not sure that it's really helpful in that respect, because we knew this, but what we were saying was, is that the correct framework, not for the NHS not to be involved, but there needs to be more connection there, I think, to with regard to a number of issues. So it's quite a short response, and it basically tells us what we know, but it would be good maybe to probe a wee bit further into how it could work better.
Thanks for that.
Yep. That's helpful. I mean, given that if the responsibility of healthcare, both before, during and after someone is within the custody of SPS, is not the responsibility of the SPS at any point during that journey, then clearly asking the SPS more questions about it will probably elicit very little. It may be more helpful if we write to the Health Secretary, to whom the NHS is under responsibility instead, because obviously every health board will be responsible for the institution within their own board. But from a nationwide point of view, it is, I think what is evident is that there is a, you know, people have access to certain levels of care and treatment, especially around addiction, mental health and so on, whilst they're in custody. But when they leave, especially if they're held in custody in an area which is not their home board, so they're, if you want, a visitor in that health board, that there's clearly a disparity of services. There's issues around data, around records, moving around. I don't think it's as seamless as people perhaps would like us to think it is. But I think these are questions, therefore, if they're not justice questions, then they're certainly health questions. If it's the NHS who are ultimately responsible for these folk. Because what we're not seeing is, and it's part of the through care conversation that we've been having, and I think we saw that at first hand on our committee visit, it's actually really important to get people, you know, keep people on the straight and narrow. That's quite easy to do in a managed environment and less easy to do out in the real world. So I think these are questions that perhaps only the Health Secretary could answer.
Okay, any other comments? No. I entirely agree. I think it's one that we do follow up. I'm minded perhaps to suggest that we write to the Chief Medical Officer, really just because I see this more as a sort of operational delivery issue, and ask for some information about what changes can be made and improvements can be made, because this has obviously been raised on more than one occasion with the committee. I think it was raised during our visit to the WISE group and also during our recent visit to the Women's Custody, new custody unit in Glasgow. So I would certainly be suggesting that we write, it would just be a question of who we write to. As I say, my proposal would be perhaps starting with the Chief Medical Officer and ask for some appropriate information.
Point that was made to us during the trip to the new facility in Maryhill was that each health board seems to have a different approach. So the frustration of the SPS was that there wasn't a consistency. So it'll be interesting to make that point if we're writing to them.
Yeah, exactly. I think that was highlighted a couple of times, that sort of issue around health boards as opposed to NHS Scotland sort of oversight.
One of the things that I think I asked at the time was when they're transferring from one, health board to another, when they're transferring from one prison, when they're progressing through as well, there is still an issue. And despite Teresa clarifying that their records go with them, their medical records go with them, I'm not entirely convinced that it's as seamless as what they're saying it is. And at the heart of it, a lot of these people are suffering from varying degrees of mental health and addictions, and that should be a seamless approach.
Yeah, I agree. Gona?
I agree with your suggestion that we write, you know, and I agree with Jamie, as a health board. But depending on the responses from that correspondence, you know, if we had time in our schedule, would it be possible to have a round table session with everybody to discuss it, or with health board representatives, Scottish Prison Service, etc.? Because sometimes more gets done if it's a face to face conversation, and that might, because clearly it is an issue, and as you say, we hear about it a lot, and the WISE group have concerns about it. But I'm not sure whether that's a practical suggestion, but. Rather than just correspondence, I wondered whether that would move things on a bit.
Yeah, I think that's a really good idea. Stephen's just reminding me that we've got a sort of kind of plan in progress to have a sort of round table looking at mental health, and we could maybe incorporate that into that discussion. But certainly I think that's a very valid suggestion to make, because you say that face to face.
I mean, it doesn't need to be a full morning session, but you know, even just for an hour or an hour and a half, to get people together and say, you know, here are the issues from our side, and this is the process just now, and on the basis of that, we could follow up with the Cabinet Secretary of what was said, but just putting out there. But I agree with your initial plan to write.
Thanks, Rona. Jamie?
Two things. One is, I think that's a very useful idea. As always, it's more powerful to hear from those who've been through that journey than people who turn up with briefcases and suits and tell us how wonderful everything is. Secondly, it might be helpful if we keep the Parliament's Health Committee abreast of what we're doing in this space, or indeed invite them to participate somehow by writing to the convener or copying them in the correspondence that we send on this matter.
Yeah, good suggestion. Okay, so Can we agree then that we'll look at, maybe the clerks will help us look at an opportunity to incorporate a discussion about this particular issue within our forthcoming session, looking at more policing and mental health, but this is a very sort of relevant and related issue that I would certainly be happy that we incorporate into the discussion. Stephen, do you want to add anything?
Just briefly, Convener, yes. So the session I was referring to was not so much policing mental health. It was the session that you'd agreed to look at the overlap between health, criminal justice and mental health issues of prisoners, and perhaps wrapping the medical issue in relation to drugs and health board issues you could incorporate into that, Convener.
Yep, perfect. Members happy with that idea?
Yep.
Perfect, thank you very much. Okay, our next letter is the correspondence from the Crown Agent on centralisation of case marking. Any comments on that correspondence? I think this was an issue that our colleague Pauline McNeill first raised. Nope. Happy with the Russell?
For what it's worth, I think it's quite a useful letter. It's something that we've heard there are problems or objections to from some quarters, but I think it does lay out quite clearly the benefits. There's greater consistency and, I think, efficiency, so quite reassuring.
Yeah, no, I would agree. I actually found it very helpful. It set out quite a lot of information that had either slipped off my radar or I wasn't aware of, so I certainly found it helpful. If Katie?
Yes. One of the issues that we discussed at the Away Day events was the consistency in relation to the Crown's position on bail, and we presumed that that wasn't dealt with at the centralisation process because of the fact that people would be appearing from custody at short notice and it therefore simply wouldn't be practical, but it would be quite helpful to get a clarification on that about how they attempt to ensure that there's consistency across Scotland in relation to the Crown's position on bail and bail applications, which I suspect is dealt with in a slightly different way than is outlined in this letter.
Yeah. I'm assuming that I think I would agree with you. I would assume that's not something that the unit would, or the centralised process would consider, but that's maybe something that may come up in the bail and release bill. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, it's just that I would have thought there might well be a process to try and ensure that there is consistency, even if it's in retrospect. I don't know. It just would be interesting. Maybe in time for the bail and release bill to have that information before us.
Okay. Stephen, do you want to come in on that?
Just to remind members that we'll be bringing forward a paper 21st of September on the approach to the bail and release bill, and there are some ideas in that paper for how to engage with the Crown Office around how they make their recommendations on bail decisions. So maybe if we can take forward Ms. Clark's suggestions for how to get some sort of clarification as part of that process of engaging with the Crown Office on that bill.
Yeah. Members happy with that? Yep. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, our next letter was from COSLA on the funding provision for secure care. Comments? Colette?
Yeah, I'm going to sort of focus in on the actual procurement process in which the local authorities go through. And the only reason why I'm going to do that is because I've experience of it myself. The one concern I've got is about the cross-border placements. It doesn't actually align with the promise. And that ties in with that as well. And whilst I welcome what was said and the programme for government, I'd be keen to get more clarity on how many secure beds there are within Scotland. Is there enough? Placing young people cross-border is a challenge, and I know even from having worked in a children's care home myself, there was a substantial amount of requests from down south to place young people up here as well. And I just feel that at the heart of it, we're not looking after their well-being by doing that. So I would like to seek more clarity on that and see if we're like producing more. And Scotland's Excel are the ones that have got the framework for this, and they are very robust in terms of how they go about doing it. Obviously, they've got to meet certain aspects from the Care Inspectorate as well as SSSC on this as well. But and a lot of the times as well, the local authorities are jumping at the bit trying to get secured beds on a Friday, and there's no staff available within the local authorities over the weekend as well. So that can be a challenge. So it's just making sure that there's a more seamless process and that the procurement and that there is more secure beds available so that they're not getting put into a prison estate.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks very much. I'll bring in Rona and then Jamie and then Fulton.
Okay, thanks, convener. I can only really speak for the situation in the secure care home in my constituency, St Mary's. And in that instance, yes, that there are enough beds. There are always enough beds. And the cross-border placements coming up from England were part of the financial solution to the funding. So I think we're definitely moving in the right direction. I'm really pleased to see a focus in this at last. I think, you know, we are heading in the right direction. It's quite a timid start. The Scottish Government has agreed to pay for the last bed in each of the four secure centres as it becomes available. And there is always a bed available in St Mary's. And the short-term objectives of the funding are to reduce the number across border placements as required by the promise. I mean, Colette's right. I mean, we have to completely think about the young people involved in this. You know, that said, that there aren't enough secure places in England. That's why they're coming up here. But we've been using that as a way to fund our system, which hopefully we're looking at it and saying, well, you know, it needs to be a different framework. But, you know, I'm quite optimistic that this is hopefully the start of a journey for getting that process better. And I'm quite, you know, glad to see that something's been done at last. Thank you.
Jamie,
yeah, I find this letter very helpful, actually, and I think it maybe speaks to certainly my own personal lack of understanding of the status quo. I think it can often be confusing or confused as to who's placed where and why, and this letter was quite eye-opening. Clearly, there are enough beds. The snapshot that we had, there were 78 secure beds in Scotland. At that time, only 38 were being used. But interestingly, of those, the majority were there on care and protection grounds, and only one were sentenced. And that's important, because those who are placed through care and protection are funded, or the responsibility to be funded, by local authorities. And those who come through the justice system are the responsibility of funding through the Scottish Government. And at that time, well, January 2022, I don't know what the number is today, only one young person was in secure care, having been sentenced. The question is, therefore, and I think this is something we maybe could do with some help and understanding for those of us who are less experienced in the system than others, is, and especially in the context of legislation that was announced yesterday around children in care and justice as they interact with those sections of government, is on which grounds would someone be placed in secure care versus a young offenders institution versus an adult prison? And there clearly is crossover. There are clearly people in the wrong place at the wrong time, but it doesn't seem to make sense given that we know there is availability in secure care. And I think my lack of understanding of that journey, or that flowchart, leads us to believe that it can be quite, as we will naturally have to go in and look at this legislation, it would be helpful to understand the landscape of knowing what the right path is for people, what the government wants to do next, if there are changes that are going to be made, because clearly the government's getting some flack about young people being seen to be in the wrong institution. But yet we're hearing that there's plenty of availability, so much so that we're shipping people up from south of the border, presumably because that's been funded by others. So I would quite like a little bit of understanding about that. I'm also interested in the short-term model that they talk about, which starts this month for 6 months as a trial. I don't really understand it. I see what it does, but it says that the Scottish Government has agreed to pay for the last bed in each of the four contracted secure centres as it becomes available. I'm not 100% sure what that means. So maybe this is a session, perhaps an offline session that we have. Someone could just explain to us what happens, you know, if you're... What's the difference between someone in protective care versus someone who's gone through the justice system having committed some form of offence? What options are available to people, how they interact with the criminal justice system as children? And I don't necessarily know if that's within the full remit of this committee or not, but I think this letter certainly raised a whole bunch of questions for me.
Okay, thanks, Jamie. Thornton, were you wanting to come in as well?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Like others, I broadly welcome this letter, but I think, as Ronan Mackay said, it could have went a bit further, I think. excuse me. I think that you know, after the announcement of the programme for government yesterday, I do think that it's probably the trial period is to set ourselves up for that, where there'll be nobody under the age of 18 in a custodial setting. And you would imagine that if some of these young people are going to secure care on the through the criminal justice system, then there'll be an implication for Scottish Government funding, because, as Jamie Green rightly said, the letter does state there's only one young person in secure care who was sentenced. In terms of the cross-border issue, I've raised this before in committee. You know, my time as a social worker, this isn't new, so I've got some concerns with this. And when I used to work as a social worker, a trip down to the north of England wasn't an uncommon occurrence. Also to the north of Scotland, similar distance. And similarly, when going out to visit secure care centres, here, young people were making relationships with people from various places in England, so that it was a two-way thing. So it's going to be particularly difficult, I think, to just stop that when both partners are clearly relying on it. Now, I'm not saying that it's going to just be stopped, because obviously it says to reduce the number of cross-border placements, which I'm assuming they're referring to Scottish kids going cross-border. But in either scenario, I think that the government will need to be speaking to the relevant stakeholders in England and Wales about that. Because if young people don't have space in England, then they're going to continue to need to use it, and no government's going to turn away a young person, if that makes sense as well. But we're obviously needing to increase capacity here to meet the policy objectives, you know, that's going to be how we treat our young people who are sentenced. So I think there's big discussions there, because this is not new. This is going back decades, cross-border thing. I might be wrong, and somebody, a stakeholder watching this might feel free to pull me off this, but I think it came historically, you know, from a decades-old assumption that kids who were maybe needing secure care, it was better to get them way out the community of which they were in. You know, the thinking's changed around that, but the historical placement of kids has not, if that makes sense. So I think it came from that basis, maybe 70s, something like that. You know, if a kid's, you know, needing some time away, you get them a couple hundred miles away. So I think it's came from that, but that'll be a real issue to deal with, the cross-border thing, I think.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other comments? No. Okay, thanks for that. Very helpful views. I absolutely agree. Again, from my own sort of professional experience, the sort of historical rationale for cross-border placements probably made sense at that time, but we're now in 2021 and our thinking has moved on. So definitely a real issue. Jamie, you mentioned the Children's Justice Bill that was mentioned in the programme for government yesterday. So I'm wondering if members would be in agreement that we come back to this perhaps in the autumn, once we sort of see where that is going. And in the meantime, we can sort of flag our interest in this to the lead committee on that, and also the Bureau once the bill, when the bill is referred. So, members happy with that proposal? Yeah. Okay, thanks very much. Thank you. Okay, we're getting there. So our next letter is from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, just providing an update on their use of naloxone. Again, happy to open it up, Russell.
Yeah, so 7 months ago, the First Minister and the Drugs Minister attended a fire station, and the headlines stated that firefighters are to start carrying naloxone. With the announcement came £90,000 of funding to train officers. And what this letter tells us is that 1,226 members of staff have been trained, but what it doesn't tell us is how many are actually carrying naloxone. It also omits to make any reference to what I believe is some form of disagreement or dispute between the Fire and Rescue Service and the Fire Brigade Union about this issue. I think there's perhaps a sense among some officers, this presumption that they should carry it without any reassurances about liability for use or misuse, and those questions being unanswered. So I think it would be useful to ask the Fire and Rescue Service what is actually happening, is it being used, and what are the issues, if any.
Okay, thanks for that. Anyone else? No. I think you're right. There doesn't seem to be any indication that naloxone is being used at the moment, or certainly carried. I'm more than happy to write and ask, raise the points that you've made, just to get a bit more detailed update on progress around that. Members happy with that? Yep. Okay, thanks very much. So our next letter is our correspondence from Martin Evans, Chair of the Scottish Policing Authority, about changes to the police pension scheme, and also the associated letter from David Page, Deputy Chief Officer at Police Scotland. Again, I'll open it up to comments, and that was in relation to some correspondence that we had written requesting an update on the progress around the impact of the pension scheme changes. Russell.
Happy to go first. There's a lot in both letters. We're taking both at the same time, effectively.
Yeah, just as easy.
Okay. Well, I know it's primarily about pensions, but there's other issues in there. Now, up top of the David Page letter, there's talk about the importance of being mindful of police officers' physical, emotional and mental well-being. But, you know, back in June, we heard evidence of suicides among police officers and what appeared to be a lack of any meaningful attempt to get to the bottom of that. There was a particular phrase that was used in an exchange between the SPA and Police Scotland that the SPA had asked Police Scotland for some information. This had been explored, and the direct quote was, based on information available at that time, there was nothing to suggest any of the recent cases were caused directly by the pressure of work. Now, I think that's not the case, and I think it's worth revisiting. There's cases I'm familiar with where it very much looks like the pressure of work and the work environment and other issues around that did or were contributory factors. So it's just to put that on the record. Going back to the pension issue, one of the two officers, senior officers, who are chairing the Operational Priorities, Capacity and Resilience Group into this issue of the change in pension rights and the large numbers of officers who have left and may continue to do so. Now, this particular officer, Bill Kerr, has ironically also just announced that he is leaving to take up a post with another police force. So interesting to know who's taking his place on that committee. But I think the main issue, and I'm sure other colleagues will have plenty to say on this, is the very stark warning from David Page towards the end of his letter about the proposed budget and the impact that will have on policing in Scotland. I won't read it out here, but it's clearly extremely concerning and comes just a couple of months after the Chief Constable told the SPA that the proposed budget would have a significant impact on the numbers of officers who will be serving communities. So, thank you.
Okay, thanks, Russell. Did you want to come in, Katie?
Yes.
And then I'll bring in Jamie.
Thank you. And it was really, I presume this is something that we will look at in detail as part of our budget review process and scrutiny of the budget process. I said earlier in the meeting, my understanding is that the budgets for the justice sector across the board are being cut by approximately 20%. That obviously won't necessarily be an even cut. And that was before the levels of inflation that we currently are expecting. So I presume we will get a lot more detail about this and we'll be able to scrutinise it in more detail about what the impact of that's likely to be in specific sectors, but particularly police, in our budget scrutiny process. So it was just to say, I think, you know, we do want to be calling for more evidence so that we can look at that, because I think we do want to know how the police intend to respond to that and where it is that there's likely to be cuts, because again, they're going to make strategic decisions about how they're going to respond to that. And it may be that certain types of work are given more protection than others, and certain, you know, staff are prioritised over others. And it would be interesting to get more information about that as part of the budget making process.
Thanks, Katie. Jamie, did you want to come in, and then I'll bring in Colette?
Just for clarification, I'm sure the pressure on the police has come up before, and my understanding is there's several pilot schemes being run where there's like a fifth emergency response service being piloted in like Dundee and whatnot, where it's like mental health responders. So it takes the pressure off police who have in the past and are still the first responders to cases like that. So it'd be interesting to see how that pilot scheme runs out. And I know I've had conversations and written correspondence from the Minister for Mental Health. So that's maybe something that we could follow up on. Something that could possibly mitigate the challenges that Police Scotland are facing in terms of that as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Jamie?
First of all, associate myself with those comments. I've always been a long believer that the police are mopping up the job of other emergency and public services. We know that. We've heard that in this room from them, be it, you know, social care, dealing with health situations, driving people to hospitals, dealing with overdoses, mental health breakdowns and so on. And that's really taking up quite a lot of their time and work, adding to their stress levels, which I think leads me on to my points about the letter from David Page, which is the sort of letter I would expect to read probably from the SPF rather than from the police force itself, given the tone of it. The first point I'd like to make is that should be of concern to the committee, I think, is we know the issue around pensions and retirements, but one thing that flags me is what we are seeing is proportionately a loss of quite a large number of officers with considerable experience. And I think we have talked about that in the past, but and there's no easy fix to that. You know, it takes time on the job, I guess, to accumulate experience. But if you are losing 718 officers who have more than 25 years' experience out of the 1,137 who left or planning to leave, well, that's a huge chunk. We also should note that 1 in 10 of those leaving the service are not doing so through normal attrition. They're doing so because of a lack of resources as being their primary reason. 1 in 10 is quite a lot. And I think the letter goes on to explain why that is the case. But that's something that should be of concern to us as well. And that's something I think we should be asking the government what they're doing to address that. The other point is, what I am slightly worried about is, they're obviously saying that with the budget available to them, we're focusing on the three key business areas, of which probably are focusing on their statutory duties, C3, response policing, public protection. They state quite explicitly that some work in other business areas may be stopped or scaled back as we prioritise our work. These are not decisions that will be taken lightly, I understand why, and our focus will always be on the most vulnerable in society. What it doesn't really do is elicit what other business areas will be scaled back, what other capital investment projects will be stopped or not go ahead or paused. what other projects are the police involved in, whether it's education, whether it's, you know, what else do the police do that they would see as superfluous to the core product that they have to deliver by statute? And it's really unclear what these things are. And I would be worried that there may be things in there that actually are more important, especially in the preventative agenda, that will lead simply just to problems down the line. Are we just delaying those problems? They also say that we're seeing the impact of fewer officers across a range of operational areas. Which operational areas would be my question, including our responsiveness to calls from the public? Well, does that mean their ability to respond to emergency calls? Does it mean the time scales that it takes them to respond to calls? Whether the calls are answered, how long the calls take to be answered? And as we know from information that came out last week, whether those calls are even being processed. We learned last week that data has been entered into a system that wasn't even being recorded. Are these a result of human errors or technical issues due to lack of investment in ICT? And these are all questions I have. So all this has done is flagged up a whole conversation that we need to be having with the police force, with the minister, because this is quite serious stuff. They say that it will have a serious impact on Police Scotland and our likely workforce numbers if what was put out in the RSR comes to fruition. We hope it doesn't, but we know there may be an emergency budget, which I think this committee will have a role to play in. And I think we need to be quite nimble in responding to that. So I would like to hear from Mr. Page and or others come to the committee and tell us more about some of these issues, because I think this is just opening up a can of worms.
Okay. Anybody else want to come in? Rona?
Yeah, I mean, Jamie's right. I mean, this is exactly the sort of issue that we'd have been, you know, we'd have drilled into in the police subcommittee. And so I think we need to definitely set some time aside to to try and get some answers. Yeah.
Thanks very much for that. Yeah, Russell.
I mean, I do agree with Rona that it's probably necessary, but I do think the Scottish Police Authority, that is their job, or it's at least supposed to be, and you know, they should be asking these tough questions.
Thanks very much. So really just to kind of pull this together, I mean, in terms of both pieces of correspondence, obviously Mr. Evans updated that one of their committees, I think their People Committee, is leading oversight, if you like, around police numbers. They received an update back in June, and at that time they were sort of satisfied with where work was taking Police Scotland in terms of responding to the numbers leaving. And I think they had asked for further information, particularly around the reasons for leavers, which to some extent is set out in the correspondence. Again, in terms of performance, I think Mr. Evans updated that there appropriate committee, Policing Performance Committee, is monitoring that, and I took a little bit of reassurance from that in terms of policing performance. And then obviously the a very important area as well is well-being, which we have been looking at recently within the committee. On that note, members will know that we have a session coming up looking at the issue that I mentioned earlier around policing and mental health, both in the context of the response to poor mental health, which we've spoken about in communities, but also the impact of the demands of policing on police officer and staff mental health. So I would certainly be looking for us to probe within that session on the issues that we've spoken about today. In terms of the financial issues that we've raised and the constraints, or certainly the forthcoming constraints around budget, we will obviously be looking at that closely within our forthcoming budget scrutiny process, which will be around about
late October.
So there's a lot for us to think about and discuss, and I would anticipate that both Mr Evans and Mr Page will be invited to give evidence at our evidence sessions on budget. So if members are agreed, we'll take the issues that we've discussed today forward within those two forums. Jamie?
I think the second forum is appropriate because it's budget scrutiny and we'll have valid cause to question our witnesses on the implications of the budget, whether it's the planned budget or an other emergency budget that arises. But I think the other session is perhaps more of an informative one, which I don't think is the right climate for getting into some of the nitty-gritty of some of the questions that I raised, for example, which are geared far more at the at management level. I would be, you know, minded to thank Mr. Page for his letter, but go back to him with all the questions, and they'll be on the official report that we have from across members, and go back to them in writing, say we'd like a little bit more from you in advance, because I don't think we should wait till the end of October before we hear from them again. So, you know, I would politely request that we do go back asking some further clarification on what some of this means, because there are a lot of things being said, but it's not clear what the detail is.
I mean, on that note, we have, I mean, Stephen's reminded me that we have already started to sort of seek some of that information. I agree, I think that's a good point that you raise. Another option would be following the session that we have on policing and mental health, we can then have a sort of follow-up session to consider the session and other issues that we've that have been raised. Members be in agreement to that, Rona?
Just to say, can we also follow up Colette's suggestion about finding out how the pilot in Dundee is going with
it? Yep, absolutely. Yep, yeah. Sorry that. Yep. So, members happy with that?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah,
okay. That, yeah. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, and our final letter is from Police Scotland. And that was a response in relation to tackling online child abuse, grooming and exploitation. Again, I'll open it up to members. Russell?
Just one point. I mean, obviously, this is one of the most serious subjects and areas in which the police are working. And the letter in front of us does touch on the point Jamie Green made about the bigger budget concerns, and the letter writer acknowledges that in these financial circumstances, putting more money into it is probably not going to address the issue and probably isn't a feasible option. So it will be very interesting to see what they're proposing in December. So I think we should be just putting that in the diary and giving it a good look when it comes along. So.
Okay, thanks, Russell. Anyone else? I'm happy to take that suggestion forward. I thought the update was very helpful. This is a growing and serious area of police work, and I think it's right that we maintain a sort of a watching brief over how things progress in terms of the policing response and policing resource around it. Related to that, we had an opportunity to, or had an invitation extended to visit the Stop It Now offices. So we can certainly take that forward. I'm not sure if that's in the diary or if it's...
I think we don't have a diary date yet, but we were looking to do that this side of this calendar year. So we were just going to approach Stop It Now team and see what dates they might have available, and then come back to the committee to see who might be available for that visit.
Thanks very much, Stephen. Fulton, do you want to come in?
Yeah, yeah, thanks. I would welcome that visit, and I welcome the letter as well. I'm just wondering as well, convener, if this is something that we'll be able to tie into our session that you mentioned earlier on policing and mental health within policing, because the reason why there might be some tie-in, it might be brought to us by officers themselves, but, you know, as you rightly said, this is a growing area of concern, so more and more officers are probably experiencing it at some level, whether it's that initial contact or, and you wonder, you know, with the nature of some of these offences or alleged offences, that the emotional impact that that could have on people. So I wonder if it's something that we could get some information from in a sensitive manner in the session coming up.
Absolutely. I would agree with that, Fulton, and also maybe thinking about staff members as well as police officers in that regard. So we'll certainly just propose that we very much keep this particular issue on our work programme and come back to it down the line. Yep, members happy with that? Okay. Oh, Rona, sorry, beg your pardon.
Proposed visit to stop it now if we're going to have it. Can you just give me some clarity and remind me what that organisation does? I have it in my head that it's about the rehabilitation of paedophiles and abusers. Is that what it is?
Yeah. You're correct. Yeah.
Right.
So they work with offenders in this particular field. So yes, mm-hmm. that's
and they would take in what we're talking about here, online abuse and things.
Yes.
Yes,
it would.
Okay. It seems to be more of an early intervention.
Yeah, it's a campaigning organisations may be too strong. They certainly work in this field both with offenders, but also, as the deputy convener is saying, there with early intervention. So people would approach them who are perhaps feeling such desires but haven't actually offended, and they will be able to provide sessions, advice, signposting to prevent those people offending in the first place. If you recall, the director of Stop It Now came along to the committee's previous evidence session.
I just want a clarification of that in my head. Thank you.
But we can provide members with just a quick reminder, obviously, before you go on that visit about Stop It Now and its work, so that you're briefed before you go.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I think that's our final piece of correspondence. So thanks, thank you very much for your forbearance. It was a bit to get through. So that concludes our public part of the meeting. But just before we move into private session, just a reminder that our next meeting will be a joint meeting with the Health and Social Justice Committees next Thursday, the 15th of September, when we'll hear evidence from Angela Constance on tackling drugs deaths and problem drug use. So this will be in place of our scheduled meeting on Wednesday, the 14th of September. So thank you very much, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.